Okay, so now let's move on to the second group. They call it as the recommendation system for adaptive e-learning, mentored by Mrs. Shukla Nag, Ms. Firoza Abra, and Mr. Nagesh Karmali. The adaptive e-learning technology extends the traditional classroom environment to make the guidance a one-to-one mechanism, that is, single machine guiding a single user. I request the team to come up.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Rakshit. This is Ashish and this is Samir. Our project is Recommendation Systems for Adaptive E-Learning. This is the outline of our presentation today. First, we'll explain the abstract, then what are the contents of our project. So, the introduction or the abstract. So, today in e-learning systems, traditionally and currently also, there's a system, there's a defined system of concept, there's a format, like a student has to follow a certain format. What we're trying to do here is to break that format, because every student need not learn in the same way. Every student is different. So, recommendation systems in e-learning is a very good field and very new field in research, which focuses on a student's need and the way students learn, rather than a fixed format of learning. Here, in our system, the course is divided into some concepts, and the idea behind our system is that concepts have dependencies between them. Concepts within a course cannot be unrelated; they are related. One of the papers he read showed that the concepts are related, and there are dependencies, values between the concepts, and all this can be expressed in the form of a fuzzy cognitive map, where this is one example, where C1, C2, C3, C4 are concepts which can be, take for example a course in C programming, which can be iterations, decision makings, pointers, arrays, all these are concepts, and there is dependency values between them. Like if you learn one concept, then your gain in knowledge of that concept affects your gain in knowledge in other concept, indirectly, you may not know that. And this is the formula, like knowledge level in a concept J, how it is affected by PI, that is a percentage increase in knowledge level of concept I. So it is basically a fractional increase multiplied by what is the dependency value. So that is how the knowledge level may increase or decrease depending on what PI is. If PI is negative, then it will decrease, and if the knowledge level in I increases, that is if PI is positive, then J will also increase. KLJ is the knowledge level of a student in concept J at time t+1, that is after he gives a quiz. T is before the quiz. WIJ is the dependency value between concept I and J. C1 to C2 is a, there's a link between C1 to C2. Yeah, so 0.45 between C1 to C3, let's say. Okay, J is C2 and I is C1. So now WIJ will be +1. PI is the percentage increase in concept 1. If a person gives the test of concept 1 and his knowledge level is some score that he gets. So if that increases, that is a percentage increase in I, that increases, then J will also increase. That is the idea. So one technique to assign these weights automatically is what Samir is going to discuss now.
So we are coming to this concept mapping. Just what we saw in the previous slide, these were the concepts that were mapped, and we see it is very important as the discussion is progressing. So the main point that arrived at was that teacher cannot give the exact concept mapping between the concepts. It may differ from teacher to teacher. So these weights were very important, so we decided to semi-automize the weight, how the teacher is going to give the weight, and it is also tedious for the teacher to give the weights. So we are just using a two matrices. We are doing a memorization technique. We are using two matrices. I'll explain the G matrix first. First is the G matrix. Now suppose there are five students S1 to S5, and there are five questions in that, okay, in a certain concept. So the 0 represent that the student gave a wrong answer for that question, and 1 represent that he answered that question correctly. This was the matrix generated when 5 students gave the responses to the 5 questions. This is called the G matrix. And I'll come to the QC matrix now. I'll just describe how the weightages are given. When a teacher adds a question to a certain concepts, suppose there are three concepts, basics of C programming, arrays and iterations. When he adds a question to iterations, we give him an option. How is this question related to basics of C programming? That he will not describe by a rating of 0.5, 0.4, but he will say that it is slightly related, moderately related, and highly related. Based on that response, we calculate the rating or the connection, the weightages are by our own system. So it will not differ from teacher to teacher. It will mostly the same. So this 0.5, these are the weightages calculated by the R system when the teacher gave, suppose he gave it, it was moderately related, this then this 0.5 was calculated. So this is the QC matrix for concepts, 5 concepts and 5 questions. Then after that we are trying to now calculate the weightages, we are trying to calculate the relation. I'll consider the G matrix now suppose, and consider the concepts, this Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5. So what is right support is how many number of right questions were attempted in Q1. So that is 2 in Q1 and 1 in Q2. So this are the one question item set is generated from that. Then we are calculating the similarity between Q1 and Q2 by doing the XOR of the Q1 and Q2 responses. So consider the first two rows of this G matrix, and now the first column 0, XOR 0, that will be 1. So we are doing it for all the students. So if we do that, we get a total of, we sum it and we get a total of 4. This similarity between Q1 and Q2 XOR will be utilized later in the next formula. When this 4 is generated, we have kept a certain cutoff, suppose that is 40%, and the number of students here is 5. So number of students into 40%, 0.4, that will be 2. This value which was calculated by the XOR, this sum should be greater than some cutoff, that is number of students into 0.4, which have the so if this suppose this is 4 value which we calculated, is suppose it was 1 for another thing, and it will not go to the second step of this concept mapping. So in the concept mapping, now Q1 and Q2 the XOR was 4, so it went for the next step, that is the Q2 question item set. So in that we calculate how much of the students have attempted the right support for that both student S5 has answered question 1 and question 2 correctly.
Logically, you have now mapped for some reason, I don't know what is right support, you have mapped for some reason two questions are similar, what do you do with that knowledge, or two questions are dissimilar?
Okay, so we calculate the,
that you are not proceeding, you dropped it in the middle and went somewhere else.
It is not calculated in one step. The what we saw, the values between the concepts, that is not calculated in one step, you can't calculate. So we proceed to calculate the confidence level, and after that the relevance is calculated. So there are 3 steps.
Confidence Q1 to Q2, right? Okay.
So there are 3 steps. That dependence is not calculated in a single step. It requires 3 steps to do that. So right support is how many number of students attempted both the questions correctly. So only the S1 student had attempted both question 1 and question 2 correctly. Hence the right support is 1 for this case.
Okay.
For Q1 and Q2. And
so
then
that, why not 3 question item set? I don't know what is the final objective of all this mathematics.
We are just calculating the mapping between the two concepts. Finally, based on this.
Concepts or questions?
First we have to calculate basis.
Then we calculate the similarity between two concepts.
You know, for one pointer question, the ideal two questions would be, that dumb students answer one question all correctly and they answer the second question all 0. The questions have to be dissimilar, is what I am trying to say.
So then,
because if it is similar questions, then I can drop one. I don't need to have both. That is the conclusion which I was hoping that you will tell me, and you are not telling me.
Okay. But then they are not.
That if there are two exactly questions, I give 2 questions to a batch of 100 students. Same 50 answer this question, and same 50 do not answer this question. I can drop one question. It does not differentiate. Okay. Fantastic technique. I am not saying no technique, but that technique I can see a clear use to drop questions.
These questions are cross concepts, right? These are not.
No, I never compare questions across concepts. I compare questions only in a concept, for the purpose which I am talking about. Across concepts, I don't see any reason to compare questions. That's why I told you politics and arrays. Is there any reason to compare it? If I am teaching C language, if I teach say variables and arrays, I am supposed to design a question bank which only tests that particular concept. Okay.
But it's not possible as you go further. Suppose you go for pointers, you will require some if else, you will require some arrays. You cannot just design a question based on
right, terms. Right. Yeah. I understand. Yeah. So there is a precedence of concepts. There is no question. This question, if I attempt correctly, my knowledge in the other thing is there. Without certain thing, I cannot learn something else. There is precedence of concept. That's perfectly fine. Okay, that can be done by the teacher.
This confidence is calculated by this formula which comes in 0.5, and now after from the QC matrix we generate a QC dash matrix, which is now consider the first C1 column of that. So for Q1 it will be 1 upon 1 plus 0.5 plus 0.3. So 1 upon 1.8. So that QC matrix is generated, that will 1 upon 1.8 is 0.55. So for all the terms, this is calculated by this formula. So all the QC matrix is obtained by that. And now we find the relevance between concept C1 and C2 based on the questions Q1 and Q2. And by this formula, QC1 into QC-22 into the confidence which we calculated in the previous one. Suppose we now calculate for Q2, it is 1 into 0.714 into 0.1 or into 1. So that comes for 0.714. So that relation is between the C1 and C2 concept based on these two questions. Similarly, we have to do this for all the questions. And then a total relevance is relation is calculated between C1 and C2 by taking the average of it. So now the user modeling will be explained by Ashish.
So then this is the user modeling where we try to store information about the model, information about the user. So user model, there are four types. It can be classified in two ways: domain related and domain unrelated. Domain related are the knowledge that are relevant to the field, say his knowledge level in a concept and all those things. And domain unrelated knowledge are those information about the user which are not relevant to the which is universally true for the user, say his personal preferences, learning style and all those things. And static and dynamic, as it is evident, it remains constant throughout the course and dynamic changes through the course. So this is we have used knowledge level of a student which varies from 0 to 1. So like this is a sample knowledge graph, so he has this much knowledge level in each concepts. So and then this is the adaptive engine. So this is the core of our project where we have four recommendation techniques. And the function of our adaptive engine is to recommend him concepts that are most suitable to him, and also recommend him some learning objects related to those concepts. So this is our first algorithm, which is maximum success path. Here, since we have the concept mapping available with us, what we are doing is whenever a student takes a concept, passes a concept, the next concept that we recommend him will be the one that results in maximum knowledge gain across all the concepts. So we, whenever a student completes a concept, we check out what will be the next concept, such that the because if he learns one concept, the knowledge level of other concepts will also change. So we try to find out which concept, learning which concept will help him gain maximum average knowledge increase across all the concepts. So that he will, like, this is basically a greedy approach where we always select the concept which will give him the best increasing knowledge levels. He will keep select learning more and more every time he will complete the course. So this is a user item collaborative filtering where the user rates the concept, and depending on the ratings of the user, we calculate the similarity between two concepts. So this is a well-known algorithm that is used in all the e-commerce websites, say Amazon and Flipkart and everywhere. They use this collaborative filtering where they calculate the similarity between two products based on the ratings provided by the user. And we are using the same modeling between concepts where we ask the user to rate the concept on various aspects. So and then we calculate the similarity between the two concepts based on the ratings provided. And then we predict the utility of a concept to a user. Say what will be the probability that the user will like this concept based on this formula. And then we predict him the when we have the prediction value for all the courses, we sort them and then we recommend the user the topmost two or three. So this is the simple algorithm. And then there's user collaborative filtering, which will be explained by Rakshit.
So that was the user item collaborative filtering that calculates similarity between items. Second is the user collaborative filtering. It calculates similarity between the users based on what courses they have taken and how they have what concepts they have taken and how they have performed in those concepts. So now traditionally collaborative filtering uses ratings. In this system, we've used the performance or the scores of the students in the test in concept. So based on those scores, we calculate the similarity between students. Now the numerator here, the SIC and SJC are scores of student I in concept C. For all the concepts that are common between these two students, we calculate, we multiply those scores. It is basically cosine similarity. So now the courses that are not common will contribute to the denominator here for each the respective students. So now when students have more courses common, then they will have high similarity based to when they have less courses common and also their scores in those courses. When we calculate that similarity, after calculating the similarity, we calculate the prediction values. The prediction values basically what will be, what is the possible score of the student in this concept based on the other similar student scores in the given concept. Like I have taken 3 concepts, other person has taken 4 and 3 are similar. So what could be my score in the 4th concept based on how similar we are and how he has performed. So now after we get the prediction values, then we recommend concepts which he is likely to have high scores in. Third one will be explained by Ashish.
So user rating collaborative filtering has a very bad shortcoming that this is dependent on human rating. So a human may randomly rate something and that may not be exactly right. So user collaborative filtering overcomes this shortcoming that it's not dependent on human rating. Second, advantage of user item collaborative filtering is that we can recommend a concept without bothering about the content of that concept. So we can find similarity between two concepts without even looking into the fact whether what's the content of these two courses. Now the last recommendation technique is based on remediation. Now what we saw was students need to be recommended some concepts, like he has some misconception, like he learned a concept wrongly in the past and he has forgot that concept in the past. So we need to recommend him the concepts that he forgot, that he needs to revise. And this is a technique based on that. Here there are basically two very important parameters, which is NI and DI. NI will be the number of consecutively wrong attempts of a concept CI's questions. So like if he continuously answers questions that of concept CI wrongly, so that is that will be the NI. And DI will be the total dependency of those wrongly attempted questions on that concept. So once we have that NIDI value, we have a cutoff for 30%, where we say that if a student, like if he is answering 30%, more than 30% of the questions of a concept wrongly, even after passing the quiz of that concept, he has probably forgotten that concept and he need to revise that concept once again. Then we calculate the importance of revision, like how important it is for him to calculate to revise it. So for that, we have just simply taken the average of the two parameters, which is NI and DI, and we sorted the concepts according to the importance and we recommend him either the top concepts or all the concepts in the decreasing value. So these are our 4 recommendation techniques. The shortcoming of this is remediation model is probably for guesswork, the system don't take of the fact that some student can pass using guesswork, but we can safely assume that if the question is designed very smartly, the guesswork won't work. So the good thing about this thing is it recommends revision to the student. Like even if he has passed that course earlier, it still recommends him because the system detects that he has not, like he has forgotten that concept. Now this is one of the sample matrix that we generate for this technique. Like this signifies that the students has wrongly attended three times question 1. So here, and that question is dependent on concept C1 by 1. So here NI and DI we calculate and we check the importance value. So and we get the importance value and then we sort the concepts according to importance and recommend. And now is the evaluation model which Samir will explain.
We have also developed an evaluation model for our system to test how the users like it, what are the choices of the student, what are the suggestions for the model. So it helps in to judge the performance of the system and suggest useful changes to improve the efficiency of the system. We are taking into consideration both the implicit data and as well as the explicit data given by the users and the system. So we are using 3 techniques for the evaluation model. The first one is based on the feedback. We are providing a feedback to the student after each time he gives a quiz and checks his score. Randomly a set of questions will appear, a very less number of questions, and we'll take the ratings based on a scale of 1 to 5 for that question. The next technique we are using is the scores of the students, how much is the performance of the student in that concept. That is used for one-to-one mapping for relationship between the material and the quiz, whether it was related or not. The third evaluation is based on the ratings. During each concept, when a student is appearing for the quiz, at the end we have an overall rating system on a scale of 1 to 5. He gives his overall rating for that concept. And based on that, we calculate the 2 technical parameters, precision and recall, which I'll explain in the future slides. These are some screenshots of the system actually. and this is the future work and conclusion, and what have we learned in this system? Actually, we developed, learned a certain frameworks, languages which we knew previously. Django was very helpful for us. Then Git and LaTeX were very much important to us in our project. Documentation is important, is what all everyone thinks in FRG. The better understanding of e-learning, we didn't have a very much clear idea of how the recognition systems work. And we have also written a research paper for that, and it was a good feeling to write that paper, and this 2 months was very helpful for us to do that.